Hello there. Welcome back to the Chap's Guide. My name is Ash, and I'm your host on this journey through men's style, self-development, and personal grooming. Now, those of you who have been following this channel for a while will have heard me give some life lessons about the 10 years in my early part of my adult life where I served in the British military. This is kind of part two to that, although it is entirely standalone as an episode within itself. And today I'm going to give a similar thing. The life lessons that I learned from the second part of my adult life, and that is from the 25 years that I spent in law enforcement here in the UK. I was a police officer and I learned many things. It is fair to say from my quarter of a century employed as a public servant, protecting members of the community in all their different walks of life. So that's what we're here today to talk about, the tips and advice that I can treat you to from my life lessons in law enforcement. Now, my first life lesson is image is really important. You will find as you go through life that the way you look, the way you talk, the way you hold yourself, your very posture, tells people an awful lot about them. As we know, in human communication, body language makes up 80% of the way that we communicate, and verbal conversation only a mere 20% or so. So it's really important to remember that the way you look really impacts upon the people you encounter. And as a police officer in law enforcement, if you are squared away in your appearance, you're well dressed, you look the part, your kit is all neat and tidy on your belt, your uniform is well pressed, you hold yourself with confidence, you speak with strident conviction, the way people will perceive you will be as somebody who means business, and they will treat you accordingly. If you're trim in appearance, you look fit and capable. Your grooming is excellent. You've had a shave and you're clean cut. When you enter a situation, regardless of what it is, a traumatic situation or whatever it may be, if you look in that fashion, in effect, you look professional and businesslike. People will treat you in that way and they will have respect for you. It might be grudging respect, but they will have respect for you. I've been in many a situation where I've turned up and there's, you know, a dynamic situation unfolding. Trauma, violence, aggression. When you turn up and you look the part, you look capable and professional. Just by arriving in that fashion, it will de-escalate a situation. People will look at you, they will look at you as a person of authority, and they will amend their behavior accordingly. Merely your presence alone can resolve a situation if you look the part. That can carry across as a life lesson into ordinary life. If you are sharp and businesslike in appearance, the people that you encounter, be they clients, co-workers, subordinates, or bosses, when they see you looking sharp, squared away, well-groomed, holding yourself with poise and bearing, and when you speak with conviction and strident authority, they will perceive within you a person who is businesslike, capable, and a safe pair of hands. If you can do that, rather than de-escalating a situation by your physical presence, you can win over your clients, bosses, whatever it may be. Your appearance is really important. Now, my life lesson number two, gleaned from my 25 years as a law enforcer, is be prepared to accept the values of others. Because we all go through life and we are influenced by our personal set of values. And that begins at the very beginning of our childhood, where our parents instill within us, you know, good manners, courtesy, how to act and behave in the presence of others. And this begins to form a sort of a portfolio of values that we expect of ourselves and we expect in other people. And That's great, it's fine. But I learned that when I encountered people whose value set was very different to mine, you can't just discount them because they don't share the attributes that you expect to see in others. For instance, you know, I met many people who were homeless, who had substance addiction. Many had fallen into criminality as a consequence of some bad decisions that were made decades before, and they were still paying the price for it at a much later point in their life, where they'd been unable to have what we would consider to be a normal and ordinary, you know, course of life. If I had had a rigid set of values, I would have thought, well, you know, these are the sort of people they deserve very little of my time. They deserve very little of my attention. They're the people that you cross the road to avoid when you're walking down the street. That person who's, you know, begging for money because they don't have funds to pay for food. But in my experience, the lesson that I learned is that there is always a lot more than meets the eye when it comes to the values that somebody else displays. You know, I've met many people who give all the impressions of being, you know, wastrels, good for nothings. But in reality, they were something quite special, and an unfortunate event had befallen them. You know, many homeless people I met were military veterans, for example, who had been rendered ill, mentally ill or physically damaged, as a consequence of their service to the country. Their service for me, for you, for us, protecting us, making sure that the lives that we lead, the values that we judge others by, were safe. And, you know, it makes you think for a moment, these people, they've sacrificed a lot so that we can hold these high and mighty values. It's befitting of us just to remember that not everybody has had the fortunate path that perhaps we have. And remember, even though you might have strong values, you can't, you know, carry that over into everybody that you meet. Now, my next life lesson that I'd like to share with you is the importance of being able to communicate effectively. Now, in my old job, when I was working in law enforcement, it was necessary for me to communicate some very important messages to people. Sometimes it was life-changing information. Terrible news, the loss of a loved one, a tragedy had befallen somebody, and it was my job to tell that person that the individual they waved off that morning would never be coming back, or something terrible had happened to them. And it was important to be able to communicate that message to everyone, regardless of their class, their social status, their intellectual capability, whatever it was. I learned that it was very necessary to adapt my communication style for the audience that I was speaking to. As a detective, I interviewed many criminals who had committed absolutely heinous crimes, often against children and vulnerable people. And it was my job to interview them, to gain evidence from them through questioning and communication. And, you know, it's pointless adopting a high and mighty authoritative manner with somebody who's not going to respond to that. And I realized very quickly that, again, you have to adapt your conversation style to the person that you're speaking to your audience, to get the best outcome that you're seeking. So even though the individual I was sitting across a table from had done things which repulsed me personally, it was necessary for me to speak to them in the manner that I needed to get them to talk and communicate effectively with me. I'm afraid my fire is throwing out a bit of smoke here, but it is keeping me warm. So I realized quite early on, and the lesson really here is that you need to understand the audience when you're communicating with people. Now, over the years, I've given presentations to various conferences, international conferences. I've addressed the United Nations Public Sector Forum in The Hague. And it was a situation where I realized I would be speaking to international delegates, people who were very high-functioning diplomats. And I adapted my style of presentation very differently to the occasions when I, you know, give safety presentations to audiences of older people in the community. It required me to alter my style absolutely. And as we go through life, and this is the lesson really, put yourself in the place of the audience that you are seeking to communicate with. Think about them, how they would be best and most likely to receive the message that you're trying to transmit. When you understand your audience's mindset and how they would like to receive the information, then you can understand, as an effective communicator, how to put that message across. You can use different vocabulary, different intonation in your voice, different volumes to your voice. You can speak quietly if you know your audience have good hearing skills, and speak loudly if the opposite is the case. So the lesson is, learn to communicate effectively by putting yourself in the place of your audience. Now, my next life lesson that I learned from my time in law enforcement was, learn to embrace and protect your mental hygiene. Now, mental hygiene is just basically the science of looking after your mental health, and that also means preventing the development of mental ill health and other psychoses that might come your way. Because I learned through my time, over the many years, that everybody is susceptible to mental ill health as a consequence of the trauma and the experiences that we encounter. And not enough of us know when to recognize that something in the balance of our lives is out of tilt. Most of us will, of course, know how to look after our bodies. If we gain a bit of weight, we alter our diets so that we return to a healthy weight. If we want to get fitter, we go out for a run. We do whatever exercise that we need to do. These are the things which we understand will make our bodies fitter and stronger. But we don't generally apply the same mindset to our mental well-being. I found it really important to understand when my balance was off, when I'd experienced so many things that it was making me feel unwell. My mental hygiene was negatively impacted. And when that was the case, I learned that it was important to speak to people about it professionally. I spoke to psychologists in the nature of my work who were there to make sure that I was operating most effectively and that the experiences I was encountering professionally weren't causing me ill consequence with my mental hygiene. Equally, you can speak to colleagues. There are other people who can share that burden with you. It helps your mental well-being to have people who understand what you're going through around you. I realized that to keep my balance, I needed to have things to help me decompress. And that was hobbies, whatever it may be. Going for a run, in my case, it often was, or going to the gym, or doing other things. It might be stamp collecting, or bird watching. Whatever helps you to decompress would help the balance get back on an even kilter. But if you go the other way and you don't look after your mental health, the consequences can be rather dire. Now, the lesson here is to learn the signs in your life that suggest that you are out of balance. That might simply be noticing that you're not sleeping so well. You're drinking a little bit of alcohol to help you forget things. Or, you're not eating very well. You're not taking exercise. You've lost interest in your hobbies. When you see things like that starting to happen, perhaps it's time to take a more proactive approach to your mental hygiene. Embrace it and protect it, because if you look after your mind generally will be very good at looking after you. Now, my last life lesson for you is, every day is a gift. All right, in my previous profession, it brought me into contact every day almost with sudden and unexpected death or tragedy for people who crossed my path in the nature of my work. Good people, decent people, who left the house at the beginning of the day thinking they were embarking upon just another ordinary day. And some awful thing, some traumatic event happened to them, and that was the end of their existence. And I realized, it's impossible to go through a job for as long as I did in the nature of my work, seeing things like that on frightening regularity. and not to think, good God, that could so easily have been me. And I learned that it doesn't matter if you're the most careful person in the world, if you run marathons, if you're a vegan, if you cut fat out of your diet, it doesn't matter. An accident can happen to you and it can all end just like that. I have come to perhaps understand more than most the fragility of human life, how lucky we are to have this brief moment that our lifetimes are of, you know, happiness, of being perhaps as I am today in the outdoors in the spring in the United Kingdom. There's a clear sky, it's a crisp, fresh day. This is an absolutely wonderful moment in my life. I'm very lucky. I know that will come to an end at some point because everybody's life journey heads in one indefatigable direction. We all know what that final destination is. We just don't know when it's going to happen. And that is why when somebody says to me, how are you? I often respond by saying, every day is a gift. I mean it as an upbeat, positive salutation. And it is very true. It strikes absolutely at the heart of the way that I approach every day in my life. It is a gift. It is a gift to be sat here today talking to you. It will be a gift in a moment when I go home, I sit down and have dinner with my family. Because these are brief moments in the passage of all time where I am here and I'm enjoying that moment. Because who knows? This could be my last day on this planet. I really hope not. But for somebody it will be. And it is important for us to understand and appreciate and revel in this wonderful life that we have, accept it for the gift that it is, and enjoy every moment of it. Well, folks, there we are. Those were five life lessons that I could happily share with you from my 25 years working in law enforcement. Though there were many, many more, and I'm still processing many of the lessons that I learned over that time. You know, as I think of things and they come back to me, the experiences that I had. But I hope those five lessons were of some use to you. Maybe a little more philosophical than we're used to here on the Chaps Guide channel, but I like to throw these things in now and again, just to keep you on your toes. If you have enjoyed this video, I would encourage you to give it a thumbs up. Of course, if you're not a subscriber already, click the red button, come on the journey with us. If you'd like to practically support the channel, you can buy me a coffee and you will find a link to the Buy Me a Coffee page in the show notes below. Thank you so much for listening today. I hope you can go through your life with each day being a gift. So until the next time we meet, take care.